Please welcome on stage Alexander Schulte and Sven Wüterich.
Okay, hello everyone, and thanks for joining our talk, Challenge NEOS with Biotech E-Commerce. As you already heard, I'm Sven Wüterich, and this is my awesome co-worker, Alex Schulte. We are both developers in an agile Scrum team working in WYSIWYG software design.
Yeah, thanks, Sven. So I will shortly introduce our company. Maybe you've seen it on these fancy lanyards we sponsored this way. And WYSIWYG was founded in 1994. So this year we are 25 years old. So yeah, happy birthday to us. Yeah. Currently we are around about 46 employees and maybe have around about 10 NEOS projects in parallel. So our daily business is to work with NEOS, and yeah, our goal is to develop creative concepts and lean technical solutions that are easily accessible. But today we are talking about our customer Miltenyi Biotech and the relaunch for that. Miltenyi Biotech is a global biotechnical company located in Bergstadtbach, which is near Cologne here in Germany, and they are one of the leaders in magnetic cell separation. Maybe nobody knows what magnetic cell separation is, but if I try to explain it, maybe it took a while. So it's something like filtering cells through magnetic things, and you get the cells you want for research out of this process. So Miltenyi provides products and services that support scientists and clinical researchers, and they contribute for basic research for clinical applications. And they try to enhance human health and treat severe diseases. So they try to make a cancer history, that's their claim. So, but we are talking about the relaunch project for them. So what is project vision, and what role has NEOS in all of that? With NEOS, we provide a digital ecosystem that provides the relevant information of products in the most efficient and convenient way. So we tried to relaunch the old website for them and try to make the customers searching for products very easily and try to get the information very fast and very quickly, so their customers can focus on the research and don't have to struggle searching for the products and something like that. So this was the old homepage. So maybe as you can see, it's a lot of stuff on there. Oh, sorry. A lot of stuff there. Here's something like support chats. You can register for newsletter, something like that. Here's a lot of teaser stuff, a lot of text. Here you can do things, here you can log in. But what is when you're searching for your products? Maybe, of course, you can use this product finder. Here's some news, something like that. And it's very colorful, as you can see. And of course, it was not responsive. This is our new homepage. So as you can see, it's very colorful as well. And the focus, what we did for our customer is the focus on the products. So we have product news where you can find your new instruments if you're searching for that, or here directly the search box on the homepage. So if you may know your products or searching for products, you can put it in here or filter like things here and go to the search results. And of course, it's responsive, as told. And if you may know what research areas you have or what you're searching for, maybe you search for T-cell products, something like that, or for something research areas which are here, you can directly see them in our product flyout. So after this something colorful stuff, here's the boring part. Some numbers about our relaunch project. It took us 2 years of agile development to create this new website. And with NEOS, we have in our database around about 80,000 content nodes, which results in more than 2 million Redis entries. And luckily, we only have two content dimension combinations, which is in English, language English, but in 28 country versions. And we have a default, which is international. And we had a lot of assets in our database, so we imported a lot of PDFs from our customer, and we have some editorial pictures in our database.
So, there are a lot of numbers, but what's behind the numbers? There are huge content nodes, etc. And what does the system serve for this? So, the architecture behind this is in a short nutshell right now. We have an external hosting over here, which is three environments: development, stage, and live. And we have our internal environment with several servers. One is for Jenkins, one node is for Docker, Sandbox, and Beta. And what does Jenkins do for us? Jenkins starts several jobs to create sandboxes for our developers, to make them develop fastly without any haste to create a sandbox or anything else. It's getting automatically really fast. And also the same thing for our beta environment to test new features we are currently developing. Whoop. Awesome thing. So, our three external environments are all identically. We have three Neos nodes, but the cool thing about this is that only the two front-end nodes serve front-end, no back-end. So there's the third one has the only access to Neos. There only editors can access to one environment and edit the content here. But what's the magic behind this? They all share the same MySQL server. So the data is shared between all these three servers. So we have a cool load balancing and restricted environment. They also share Elasticsearch. Everyone has share the same index and is the same Redis with own identifiers, so they have their own cache. So, Jenkins helps us to deliver our code on every environment for dev, stage, live, and our beta system. So the code rolls out, and we are luckily thankful if everything's fine. So, to make our life much better, we also added some automated tests, which also run after each each deployment for stage and live. Our tests are written in Codeception, a cool framework, which can run several kinds of tests like behavior, unit testing, and front-end testing. We do mostly front-end testing, and each test runs different commands to Source Labs, and Source Labs gives us the opportunity to run our test and all the actions on several devices and several browsers, just like Chrome and Internet Explorer. But where's the data? Our environment has our code, but where does the data come from?
Yeah, here's a short overview over our data product flow we'll give you. So our customer Miltony Biotech has a PIM, and you may know what a PIM is. In the PIM, we have the product data, which is product families, the products themselves, and a lot of prices. And we have a webshop system. The webshop system is a third-party webshop, which provides a shop API for us. So we don't really connect the PIM from the customer. The PIM exports their data to the webshop, and the shop pre-processes them for us and creates a REST API for us. So we connected our Neos system to the shop API and import these data as a node tree. So we create a node tree out of the product families and the product categories, and store the product data which we get over the REST API from the shop in extra tables. With this product data, we index them into Elasticsearch, and we use Elasticsearch to create the product list in the front end, where the customer can search for the products and get the information they need. And if the customer clicks on Add to Cart, we deliver this information back to the shop system, and we don't have to struggle with the checkout process, so because this is all in the shopping system. So this is a short overview over the product flow. But how did we get the data into Neos? As you've seen in the chart before, our customer has a PIM, and then the PIM around about 80,000 products which comes over this external shop API, and they have a lot of more stuff. They have categories and product families, which are also more than 4,000 families, and a lot of prices, really a lot. So we tried to import this efficiently into Neos. So we create a node tree out of this data. The first raft of our import was do it like you may do it in Neos. So we used nodes. We get the data from the API, try to create node data objects of them, try to persist them the Neos way. When we did that, the import took around about 6 hours to get this stuff into the database. And of course, our servers crashed due to memory limit. So what did we do to get this faster, and what was the solution for this and get this more stable? We create the node tree in only one content dimension combination. Luckily, our customer has the product data only in one language, only in English, so we are able to create only one node tree. And the product data which comes out of the external shop API are stored as plain SQL instead of Doctrine. So maybe you think, SQL, I don't know how to write it. Maybe I always use Doctrine. So, but if you are writing an import and want to get it efficiently, maybe think about how to get this more efficiently into the database. Think about the low-level system. Try to use SQL or something like that to import it. And of course, we store the node data also as plain SQL. And and after that, we have to tell Neos there's no new data into the database. And after each iteration of this data, we flush the in-memory cache of this object. This has the advantage that we freed the memory after each run. And after this rework of our import took around about 1.5 hours instead of 6 that we had before. And our servers don't crash anymore. So our memory limit was okay. So that's the solution for our import.
So you heard a lot of details about our products, but what to do with these products? We make them available in the front end, obviously. So the search is the main entry point for researchers or any customer who visit the page to getting information or buy these products. So they know the products and they have specific terms like CD34. That's a product which is some kind of fuzzy, but it's an antibody which I actually don't really know about, but do you get more details later on? And something like brain dissociation kit, but no worries, just for research only. So, and this is the homepage as you've seen before, and this is the main entry point. And the search is wide available at the beginning. We have it on the left side, and I can directly enter my search term, CD34. Or if I don't know what CD34 is, I can use these filters instead. And if I know I'm looking for antibodies or anything else, I use these filters. When I add a search term and submit my request, this search term is used by Elasticsearch to get us a filtered search result list. This is our search result list, and it's pretty fast because Elasticsearch provides us a list, and the list is rendered in React.js, which is also a cached item. So it doesn't need to fetch the data anymore or anything additionally which is needed to display the product, if it's already cached. So, but if we don't look for products, if we want to get these information, whether we know it's the product we are looking for, then we can directly click on the product and get to the detail page. Or if we are looking for content, more information, like any brochures or videos or anything else, we have the content tab, which provides us more information if we don't looking for products. But back to the search. You've seen the product view and the content view. Both is provided by Elasticsearch. We have two endpoints called here, which provides us two search lists. And right now we are back on the products. So if I don't want to have this full list, because there are many products, there's there are 152 products. This is a bit too much. Let's just go for mouse, because we know for our experiments we need some antibodies from mouse. So we click on our filter, and we directly get a new list. This was there's an Ajax call right behind this, posted to Elasticsearch, which provides us a new list with also new cached items and filtered by mouse. And this is actually really fast using React.js. But let's buy some products. Oh, there's the filter highlighted. You can also uncheck the filter if you misclicked or you want to go back to human. So this was a variant. So actually, we have a much more detailed view if we have many products, but the customer don't get overcrowded with all the products. If they know they have found their item, they can even use more details. So we have more detailed products here, and we buy one. We click on the cart item, and what happens next is we request our shop API, which has Alex mentioned before, and we get a result back, which gives us enough information that we can know for our product it's in the checkout process available, so the customer can continue, whether he go to the shopping cart or just continue shopping. So what's behind the search? Well, you already heard it. It's really much of Elasticsearch, React.js, and more. But let's see. I already mentioned that we have two indexes, which was the content and the product index, but there are way more. For this, we need to configure each custom index for every kind of index we need, because we have several more. But this is just for the search, provided for the products and content. To make this fast and independent, we separated these indexes so they don't bother each other. If you want to just update the product index because there are new products, fine. It's pretty fast to just update one index instead of a whole bunch of real old data. And for like the search, we have different entry points, which can be used just as you've seen for product, content, and more. But all the data you heard from Alex, all the Boeing numbers, that are huge data, and Elasticsearch couldn't handle with these. Just imagine Elasticsearch is a poor little guy, have a pile of data, and can't carry it out. So we had added a job queue to make it even faster and reliable that we get our search results fast. And we have some more features which are not really good to see on screenshots. So our search lists are filtered by tags, as you've seen, mouse, human, etc. But these tags are translated, so we knew there can come new languages, and these are already available, so our tags will translate in future, and we don't have any technical debts here. Same goes for a feature which is kind of nice, because clinical or research products have fuzzy names, just like Greek numbers, letters, anything else. I don't know how to type an alpha on my keyboard. I don't have a Greek layout. So these are getting translated to alphanumerical characters, which means if you don't know how to type an alpha, just type an A. It still gets your product. And if you already bought really many products, and you know which product number you're looking for, you can directly type it in, and you get to your product detail page to buy this. And it doesn't matter if you don't know where the dashes are. And also, we added auto-suggest. If you already worked with Elasticsearch or tried to implement it, it's a huge fight to getting it configured, because you've seen all the products and all the lists. It is a high customized configuration, and it's a pain. And to make our search result more reliable and more better fitting for our need, we added some more analyzers and tokenizers, just like word stemming and Edge Ngrams tokenizer, to make the search result more fitting. Just like CD34 or anything else, which has some kind of numbers, it can result that Elasticsearch puts different products instead. So, you heard a lot. We have had, this is just a few features and not really all the struggle we have had in all the 2 years, but what did we learn from all of this? Starting with indexing via the job queue I already told you about, it helped us a lot to get all the data into Elasticsearch.
Yeah, and if I said during our import process, don't think in doctrine every time. So if you really need to import a lot of data and maybe do it fast and don't crash the servers, don't get out of the memory limit, something like that, maybe think of what can I do instead of using Doctrine, which has really overloaded stuff. Maybe use plain SQL and try to get this faster with that. And a trick from us was to create the node tree with empty subnodes. Our product data, as you've seen before, is stored in extra tables, and we render this product data on the fly into the front end. So we have node templates in our database and show the data in the needed language version, but if we get more languages available for the product data, we only have this one content tree, which is always the same and can render the product data in several languages. And if you use Redis as a caching server, which we really recommend, or something like that for NEOS when you're running this in production, think about caching optimization. We have more than 2 million Redis entries in our database, and Redis isn't able to flush this efficiently. There was a talk yesterday, maybe you've heard of this. Luckily, there's an optimized cache Redis backend configuration for that. And there's a package for that. Have a look at it and try to use this, because this is the script for flushing the Redis entries is a little bit optimized, and Redis is then able to flush the data. Otherwise, your system gets stuck, and maybe what still happened in our project after a few hours after we launched it, the customer couldn't log in into the backend, and we didn't know why. So the reason why is Redis tries to flush its content, its cache content, and the whole system gets slowed down. Yeah, that was a few learnings that we had during our relaunch project. But what we achieved during our process. So we created a great website with NEOS. But yeah, all of you can create great websites with NEOS, right? So. But the cool thing is that we increased the sales for our client. So before, the customer, as you've seen in the old screenshot, the customer was overloaded with some stuff they don't need. They're searching for the products. They want to buy products. They all know the products, and they want to go directly to the products, buy them, and something like that. So the sales increased. And as I said, we've provided efficient data import. It took us some time to get this running. We tried something out, failed, do it again, do it another way, try to use this and that, and yeah. And as Sven said, we have a lot of custom searches on our website, not only the products and the content, we have a lot of more. We have some FAQ search, video search, and bloody, bloody, blah, a lot of stuff.
So, there's a lot of been struggling and really, really much sweat. And right now we are at the end of our talk, and we want to thank you everyone for joining us, but also we want to thank our great team to working with us and having a good time, because it was a really good development process with our colleagues. So thank you very much. And we want to thank our wonderful agency for that. And also thanks to NEOS and the community, because we're using NEOS to serve the system. We have we provided an e-commerce shop for researchers to make it faster and better to buy their products or get information, and thanks to NEOS. And also for the contributing community. So, thank you for joining us. If you want to know more about us, just visit our webpage, visivik.de. Thank you very much.
Thank you.